Hi everyone, it's Karnak, Star Wars Armada Explained. We're going to be looking at an objective from Rebellion in the Rim. We're going to be looking at Abandoned Mining Facility. Now, Abandoned Mining Facility, I've got it blown up nice and big on my screen for you to see right now, but at some point, so you can see what I'm doing on Vassal, I'll shrink that down. At that point, if you want to follow along, you can always go to the Star Wars Armada Wiki, go to the Rebellion in the Rim page, and then pull up the objective from there. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to read this all the way through, and then we'll dive in. Setup. The second player places the station in the center of the setup area. Then, starting with the second player, the players alternate placing the remaining obstacles, adding the two purgles and two dust fields, and excluding the asteroid fields at distance 2 to 5 of the station. After deploying fleets, each of the second player's ships gains a repair token. Special rule: each ship can resolve the following effect. Repair command. When you resolve a repair command, you get this option. It says you spend engineering points to gain victory tokens from one station or dust field at distance 1. If that obstacle is a station, you gain one token for each 3 points you spend. If that obstacle is a dust field, gain one token for each 2 points you spend. Then, if that obstacle is a dust field and you gain more than one victory token, remove that obstacle from the play area. Each victory token is worth 10 points. Okay, so before we dive into Vassal, there's a couple things here I want to touch on first before getting into it. So what we do get some of the new obstacles here. We get the purgles. So the purgles are still considered obstacles. They obstruct line of sight. There's effects in the game that revolve around, being near obstacles or not near obstacles, etc. What are the purgles' special rule from the Rebellion in the Rim booklet? It says, when a ship overlaps a purgle obstacle, that ship suffers an amount of damage equal to its speed. When a squadron overlaps a purgle, that squadron suffers one damage. At the end of each round, starting with the second player and alternating, each player chooses one purgle obstacle and moves it to within distance 1 to 2 of its current location. Each player must choose a different purgle obstacle to move. So the purgles in this situation are just kind of there to kind of move around and be shifted around. You want to try to get them in the way of other players. Now, I do want to make a note here that, again, if a ship overlaps the purgle obstacle, that ship suffers the amount of damage equal to its speed. So if it's flying speed 4, it's going to take 4 damage. This damage is not considered an attack, so it can't be braced, it can't be scattered. You can't reduce the obstacle effect unless you've got a specific upgrade card or ability that states otherwise. And if you take that 4 damage, you must suffer, whatever the speed of your ship is going, for example, if it is traveling at speed 4. If it hits a purgle, it must suffer that 4 damage to one hull zone of your choosing. You can't split it up between different areas. And any damage that you take to the hull zone of your choosing, that damage is suffered first on the shields, and then any remaining damage, if you have no shields left, then goes into your hull as face-down damage cards. So you can't do like 2 damage here, 1 damage there, and then you know what? I'm going to skip my shield entirely and take a damage to my hull. Can't do that. You pick one hull zone. That's where all of the damage goes to. Okay. And then yeah, again, if the squadrons overlap it, they get a damage. And I do want to specify that when a squadron overlaps a purgle, it needs to be from a movement, not from a placement. So what the difference is between the two is somebody decided they're going to pick up and move their squadron and put it on there. Placement is something different. This ha usually happens from like overlapping. So if a ship overlaps a bunch of squadrons, when you pick them back up, you are placing them. You're not moving them. So that doesn't lead to game-breaking effects like Mahler Miffle triggering an obscene amount of times. And also, and again, in a situation like this, you're not just throwing a bunch of squadrons on a purgle and say, "Oh, they all suffer one damage because they move there." Again, that's placement compared to movement. Okay. All right, let's get into the objective. Let me go ahead and shrink the screen down. So the Vassal module is not updated with the new Rebellion in the Rim things yet. So what I'm going to use for stand-ins, oops, we don't need to look at these cards just yet. What I'm going to use as stand-ins are these two dust clouds right here. They have objective tokens on them. Because a purgle is about roughly the size of a dust field, minus you kind of chop the tail off a little bit on these dust field clouds. So they're about the same size, so that's why I'm going to use them. To differentiate them, you know, again, I've got the objective tokens on them, but they're also facing one direction, and the regular dust clouds have got flipped and facing the other way. Alright, let's go through this step by step. The second player places the station in the center of the setup area. So in Vassal, we've got a handy dandy little marker here. It shows where the center is at. Now in terms of, you know, what is the exact center of the obstacle and the exact center of the play area, that's almost impossible to determine. Essentially is you just try to get the station as close as you can to the center. The second player will place it in the center and say, first player, this is where I feel like the center of the setup area is. And then the first player will look at it and say, nope, that's good. Or say, you know, I think more a little bit right here. Essentially, they need to come to an agreement that it is in the center of the area. If they cannot come to an agreement, if you're at a tournament, call a judge over. The judge decisions will be final. He'll place the obstacle for you. If you don't have that option, it's, you know, fly casual, guys. It's not that big of a deal. Just put it in the center. All right. Then, starting with the second player, I find it unique that some of these objective cards will say this, but then some of them don't, and they kind of have like the exact same situation. Unless the objective card specifically says otherwise, the second player always starts by placing an obstacle first before the first player. I just think it's funny that sometimes they say it and sometimes they don't. All right. So the second player places the station in the center. Then the second player gets to place the next obstacle. And you alternate placing the remaining obstacles, adding the two purgles, which we have here, and two dust fields, which we have here, and excluding the asteroid field. So these three objectives, you take them, toss them out the window. You don't get any asteroid fields, you just have debris fields, purgles, and dust fields. So you actually gain one more obstacle. Alright. And so then, you need to place them at distance 2 to 5 of the station. Then, starting with the second player, the players alternate placing remaining obstacles at distance 2 to 5 of the station. So there's a range limitation to where all these obstacles can go. It needs to be at 2 to 5 of the station. So remember, black band is distance 1, distance 1, red is 2, 3, 4, 5. So this means that essentially there's going to be a gap around the station where obstacles can't go. But the obstacles have to go within this area. And from there, you just got to make sure that the obstacles are still beyond distance 1 of other obstacles. But for there's a restriction of that needs to be outside distance 2 of the station. So you can't put anything in here. They've got to be outside distance 2. And again, not within distance 1 of another obstacle. So you can do something like this. Perfect. Oh, and for those of you who have questions about what do dust fields do, sorry. So dust fields, if a ship is attacking either another ship or a squadron, if it traces line of sight through the dust field in any capacity, it cannot conduct that attack. So even if there's two ships facing off at close range, essentially nose tip to nose tip, if line of sight is drawn across the dust field, they cannot attack each other. Squadrons can still attack through the dust field. It's just treated as obstructed like any other obstacle. Okay, so squadrons aren't affected by the dust field. Ships, when attacking squadrons or ships, if their line of sight touches the dust field at all, no attack. And I do want to very quickly point out before continuing on with the rest of the objective, is say if you have a ship breaching the dust field, for example, something like this, what happens there when you draw a line of sight? Can you conduct an attack? No, you cannot conduct an attack. The line of sight is still being traced over the dust field, regardless of what's on top of it. It's still there. It's still present. You are still technically tracing line of sight over it, through it, etc., even though there's another ship there. Otherwise, it can lead to some game breaking effects if we don't consider that as a possibility. Of course, this is not officially supported by FFG. It has been submitted as a question. This is a personal ruling, but in terms of, you know, should this be allowed, a lot of us have discussed and feel like that the developer's intent is not that you can shoot through it. So that is the ruling that we're going with. Obviously, go by whatever your TO judges in your area. But that is how I would personally rule it if I was asked to make a ruling at an event. Want to make sure I was covering that real quick. Okay. All right. So we've placed the obstacle. Sorry, went off a little bit of a tangent. But again, I want to make sure I'm trying to cover stuff. So we've placed all the obstacles. Now the next part is after deploying fleets, each of the second player ships gains a repair token. So we're going to say in this example, the Rebel player is the second player. The Imperial player is the first player. So the Rebel would get these repair tokens. Now here's the special rule for the objective. Each ship can resolve the following effect. Repair command. So we're going to go ahead and do something like this where we've deployed our ships down on the table. There we go, something like that. And you, again, even though you put the Purgle there, you can deploy your ship overlapping a Purgle. There's nothing that prevents something like that unless it's the Super Star Destroyer, for example. Maybe something like this wouldn't be most beneficial. We can just overlap the Purgle and then you just race by it. But anyway, so what's the special rule? How does it work? Well, you need to be at distance one of the station or a dust field for this to work. So we're actually going to say that this dust field had been deployed more closer down here. Again, it's out of that distance one of that other obstacle. Perfect. So a situation like this. So when you're measuring distance one, you're measuring at distance one. So for example, if this ship was off over here, you can see here that this obstacle is beyond distance one. Now it is at distance one. And when you're measuring from the physical plastic base of the ship to the closest point on the obstacle. You don't measure from the cardboard. You do not measure from the shield dials or shield frames, just the physical plastic base. Okay. So we see here he is at distance one. And you can spend engineering points to gain victory tokens. Now in the RNG for repair, it has a list of things that your repair command can do that you can spend engineering points on, such as, for example, move shields, recover shields, or repair hull. This adds a brand new fourth option that you can use. I want to specify this because some people are going to think that, oh, I can spend engineering points where I'm going to spend 6 points to regain 2 shields, and now I can get victory points because I spent engineering points, right? No, that's not how that works. It is saying you can spend engineering points to gain victory tokens specifically. You can't do stuff on your ship and then also claim victory tokens. You specifically have to spend engineering points to get victory tokens and not fix your ship, remove shields, etc. So again, it says here, if that obstacle is the station, gain 1 token for every 3 points you spend. If it is a dust field, gain 1 token for every 2 points you spend. Then, if that obstacle is a dust field and you gained more than 1 victory token, remove that obstacle from the play area. So let's take an example here, this MC-80, if it resolves a repair command and it chooses to spend all of its engineering points on sucking victory tokens from this dust field, if it also spends the repair token that it got, so it gets the 4 from the dial, 2 from the token, that's 6. So it can claim 3 victory tokens from an obstacle, but if it does that, poof. That obstacle will vanish. It's gone. You sucked all the resources dry, essentially, in one go. You sucked it too fast. Suck, suck, suck. All right. Oh, goodness. Spaceballs. But if you only choose to spend two engineering points and just only take one token at a time with each resolution for each ship, then you can get you c it doesn't go away. So for example, if this MC80 activates, it sucks just the one token, you get one token, and then when this guy activates, if he sucks, gets one token, just one token, it will stay there. It's just at any point, if any ship sucks more than one token, for essentially they spend 4 points to get two tokens, sucks it off, it's gone. No longer in the play area, it is completely removed. Now, if it's the station, you have to spend 3 points for every suck, and it doesn't go away. It stays there the entire time. And that is abandoned mining facility. So essentially, you add in purgles that move around at the end of every end of round, starting with the second player. Second player ships gets repair tokens, and then if you resolve the engineering command and you spend engineering points on sucking and not fixing your ship, you can get victory tokens. And with the station, you could suck as much as you want at 3 points per victory token. And the dust fields, you can suck. If you suck more than one token, it will vanish. And you only have to spend 2 points to get one token. And again, if you get more than one token, dust field goes away. That is abandoned mining facility. Let's talk about some of the cards. And again, I want to be make sure I'm being very clear and very specific with some things. Let's talk about Lyra Wessex. So for her situation, this happens when you're defending. You have a ship that's defending. It says here that you spend a repair token to flip a face-up damage card face down. So this is not resolving a normal repair command where you get engineering points. This is modifying your repair effect to say, I'm spending this token, and instead of spending it for its usual effect, it's doing this instead. So that doesn't trigger mining facility. Repair crews, so repair crews on flotillas, it says that engineer command, instead of spending engineering points, you may discard one damage card from one friendly ship. This doesn't matter if you spend a dial, a token, and dial and token together. It sucks all of your engineering points. So, that's how that this card works. So if you want to trigger its effect, you can't choose, oh, I'm just using the token to trigger this, and I'm using engineering dial points for this. That's not how this card works. It takes all the points. It wants it all. It's like cocaine. It wants it. There's no halvesies. It doesn't want to share. So repair crews doesn't trigger the abandoned mining facility effect. Projection experts, again, you're still resolving, an engineering command. You can spend engineering points, but again, you're spending it on projection experts, not on sucking resources from the dust fields or from the station. So again, there's no splitsies. You can't do both and still get the effect, as I mentioned before. One cool thing is that if you do have the Mon Calamari Exodus fleets, though, if you resolve these titles, you do get an extra 2 engineering points. So something like an MC80 could get 8 engineering points. 4 from the dial, 2 from the token, 2 from that card. That's 8, and it can suck a lot of resources from a dust cloud. So just some interesting things I wanted to make sure I was pointing out. Of course, if you feel like I got anything wrong, or if I missed something, or if I didn't get anything correct, please be sure to leave a comment. Let me know. I do respond to them, and of course, if I ever make any major mistakes or errors that I feel like I need to reshoot a video, I reshoot a video. Do appreciate you guys watching. I only have one more objective card to do after this, which is Infested Fields, and I'll try to get to that before I go out on a camping trip this weekend. Appreciate you guys watching, and hey, catch you next time.